Chapter 4, Part 1. Kirsty hated parties. The smiles to be pasted on over the panic, the glances to be interpreted, and worse, the conversation. She had nothing to say of the least interest to the world, and of this she had long been convinced. She'd watched too many eyes glaze over to believe otherwise. Seen every device known to man for wheedling oneself out of the company of the dull, from, "Will you excuse me, I believe I see my accountant," to passing out dead drunk at her feet. But Rory had insisted she come to the housewarming. Just a few close friends, he'd promised. She'd said yes, knowing all too well what scenario would ensue from her refusal. Moping at home in a stew of self-recrimination, cursing her cowardice and thinking of Rory's sweet face. The gathering wasn't such a torment as it turned out. There were only 9 guests in toto, all of whom she knew vaguely, which made it easier. They didn't expect her to illuminate the room, only to nod and laugh where appropriate. And Rory, his hands still bound up, was at his most winning, full of guileless bonhomie. She even wondered if Neville, one of Rory's work colleagues, wasn't making eyes at her behind his spectacles, a suspicion which was confirmed in the middle of the evening when he manoeuvred himself to her side and inquired whether she had any interest in cat breeding. She told him she hadn't, but was always interested in new experiences. He seemed delighted, and on this fragile pretext proceeded to ply her with liquors for the rest of the night. By 11:30, she was a woozy but happy wreck, prompted by the most casual remark to ever more painful fits of giggling. A little after midnight, Julia declared that she was tired and wanted to go to bed. The statement was taken as a general cue for dispersal, but Rory would have none of it. He was up and refilling glasses before anyone had a chance to protest. Kirsty was certain she caught a look of displeasure across Julia's face. Then it passed, and the brow was unsullied once again. She said her good nights, was complimented profusely on her skill with calf's liver, and went to bed. The flawlessly beautiful were flawlessly happy, weren't they? To Kirsty, this had always seemed self-evident. Tonight, however, the alcohol made her wonder if envy hadn't blinded her. Perhaps to be flawless was another kind of sadness. But her spinning head had an inept hold on such ruminations, and the next minute, Rory was up and telling a joke about a gorilla and a Jesuit, which had her choking on her drink before he'd even got to the votive candles. Upstairs, Julia heard a fresh bout of laughter. She was indeed tired, as she'd claimed, but it wasn't the cooking that had exhausted her. It was the effort of suppressing her contempt for the damn fools who were gathered in the lounge below. She'd called them friends once, these half-wits, with their poor jokes and their poorer pretensions. She had played along with them for several hours. It was enough. Now she needed some cool place, some darkness. As soon as she opened the door of the damp room, she knew things were not quite as they had been. The light from the shadeless bulb on the landing illuminated the boards where Rory's blood had fallen, now so clean they might have been scrubbed. Beyond the reach of the light, the room bowed to darkness. She stepped in and closed the door. The lock clicked into place at her back. The dark was almost perfect, and she was glad of it. Her eyes rested against the night, their surfaces chilled. Then, from the far side of the room, she heard a sound. It was no louder than the din of a cockroach running behind the skirting boards. After seconds, it stopped. She held her breath. It came again. This time, there seemed to be some pattern to the sound. A primitive code. They were laughing like loons downstairs. The noise awoke desperation in her. What would she not do to be free of such company? She swallowed and spoke to the darkness. "I hear you," she said, not certain of why the words came or to whom they were addressed. The cockroach scratches ceased for a moment, and then began again more urgently. She stepped away from the door and moved towards the noise. It continued, as if summoning her. It was easy to miscalculate in the dark, and she reached the wall before she'd expected to. Raising her hands, she began to run her palms over the painted plaster. The surface was not uniformly cold. There was a place, she judged it to be halfway between door and window, where the chill became so intense she had to break contact. The cockroach stopped scratching. There was a moment when she swam, totally disoriented, in darkness and silence, and then something moved in front of her. A trick of her mind's eye, she assumed, for there was only imagined light to be had here. But the next spectacle showed her the error of that assumption. The wall was alight, or rather something behind it burned with a cold luminescence, which made the solid brick seem insubstantial stuff. More, the wall seemed to be coming apart, segments of it shifting and dislocating like a magician's prop, oiled panels giving on to hidden boxes, whose sides in turn collapsed to reveal some further hiding place. She watched fixedly, not daring even to blink for fear she might miss some detail of this extraordinary sleight of hand, while pieces of the world came apart in front of her eyes. Then suddenly, somewhere in this ever more elaborate system of sliding fragments, she saw, or again seemed to see, movement. Only now did she realize that she'd been holding her breath since this display began and was beginning to become light-headed. She tried to empty her lungs of the stale air and take a draught of fresh, but her body would not obey this simple instruction. Somewhere in her innards, a tick of panic began. The hocus-pocus had stopped now, leaving one part of her admiring, quite dispassionately, the tinkling music which was coming from the wall, the other part fighting the fear that rose in her throat, step by step. Again she tried to take a breath, but it was as if her body had died, and she was staring out of it, unable now to breathe or blink or swallow. The spectacle of the unfolding wall had now ceased entirely, and she saw something flicker across the brick, ragged enough to be shadow, but too substantial. It was human, she saw, or had been. But the body had been ripped apart and sewn together again, with most of its pieces either missing or twisted, and blackened as if in a furnace. There was an eye gleaming at her, and the lather of a spine. The vertebrae, stripped of muscle. A few unrecognizable fragments of anatomy. That was it. That such a thing might live beggared reason. What little flesh it owned was hopelessly corrupted. Yet live it did. Its eye, despite the rot it was rooted in, scanned her every inch, up and down. She felt no fear in its presence. The thing was weaker than her by far. It moved a little in its cell, looking for some modicum of comfort. But there was none to be had. Not for the creature that wore its frayed nerves on its bleeding sleeve. Every place it might lay its body brought pain. This she knew, indisputably. She pitied it, and with pity came release. Her body expelled dead air, and sucked in living. Her oxygen-starved brain reeled. Even as she did so, it spoke. A hole opening up in the flayed ball of the monster's head, and issuing a single, weightless word. The word was... Julia. Chapter 4, Part 2. Kirsty put down her glass and tried to stand up. "Where are you going?" Neville asked her. "Where do you think?" she replied, consciously trying to prevent the words from slurring. "Do you need any help?" Rory inquired. The alcohol made his lids lazy, and his grin lazier still. "I am house-trained," she replied. The riposte greeted with laughter all round. She was pleased with herself. Off-the-cuff wit was not her forte. She stumbled to the door. "It's the last room on the right, at the end of the landing," Rory informed her. "I know," she said, and stepped out into the hall. She didn't usually enjoy the sensation of drunkenness, but tonight she was reveling in it. She felt loose-limbed and light-hearted. She might well regret this tomorrow, but tomorrow would have to take care of itself. For tonight, she was flying. She found her way to the bathroom and relieved her aching bladder, then splashed some water onto her face. That done, she began her return journey. She had taken 3 steps along the landing when she realized that somebody had put out the landing light while she was in the bathroom. And that same somebody was now standing a few yards away from her. She stopped. "Hello?" she said. Had the cat breeder followed her upstairs in the hope of proving he wasn't spayed? "Is that you?" she asked, only dimly aware that this was a singularly fruitless line of inquiry. There was no reply, and she became a little uneasy. "Come on," she said, attempting a jocular manner that she hoped masked her anxiety. "Who is it?" "Me," said Julia. Her voice was odd, throaty, perhaps tearful. "Are you all right?" Kirsty asked her. She wished she could see Julia's face. "Yes," came the reply. "Why shouldn't I be?" Within the space of those 5 words, the actress in Julia seized control. The voice cleared, the tone lightened. "I'm just tired," she went on. "It sounds like you're having a good time down there. Are we keeping you awake?" "Goodness me, no," the voice gushed. "I was just going to the bathroom." Pause then. "You go back down. Enjoy yourself." At this cue, Kirsty moved towards her along the landing. At the last possible moment, Julia stepped out of the way, avoiding even the slightest physical contact. "Sleep well," Kirsty said at the top of the stairs. But there was no reply forthcoming from the shadow on the landing. Chapter 4 Part 3. Julia didn't sleep well. Not that night, nor any night that followed. What she had seen in the damp room, what she'd heard and finally felt, was enough to keep easy slumbers at bay forever. Or so she began to believe. He was here. Brother Frank was here, in the house, and had been all the time. Locked away from the world in which she lived and breathed, but close enough to make the frail, pitiful contact he had. The whys and the wherefores of this she had no clue to. The human detritus in the wall had neither the strength nor the time to articulate its condition. All it said before the wall began to close on it again, and its wreckage was once more eclipsed by brick and plaster, was Julia. Then simply, it's Frank. And at the very end, the word blood. Then it was gone completely, and her legs had given way beneath her. She'd half fallen, half staggered backwards against the opposite wall. By the time she gathered her wits about her once more, there was no mysterious light, no wasted figure cocooned in the brick. Reality's hold was absolute once again. Not quite absolute, perhaps. Frank was still here, in the damp room. Of that, she had no doubt. Out of sight he might be, but not out of mind. He was trapped somehow between the sphere she occupied and some other place, a place of bells and troubled darkness. Had he died? Was that it? Perished in the empty room the previous summer, and his spirit left there awaiting exorcism. If so, what had happened to his earthly remains? Only further exchange with Frank himself, or the remains thereof, would provide an explanation. Of the means by which she could lend the lost soul's strength, she had little doubt. He had given her the solution plainly. Blood, he'd said. The syllable had been spoken not as an accusation, but as an imperative. Rory had bled on the floor of the damp room. The splash had subsequently disappeared. Somehow, Frank's ghost, if that it was, had fed upon his brother's spillage and gained thereby nourishment enough to reach out from his cell and make faltering contact. What more might be achieved if the supply were larger? She thought of Frank's embraces, of his roughness, his hardness, of the insistence he had brought to bear upon her. What would she not give to have such insistence again? Perhaps it was possible. And if it were, if she could give him the sustenance he needed, would he not be grateful? Would he not be her pet, docile or brutal at her least whim? The thought took sleep away, took sanity and sorrow with it. She had been in love all this time, she realized, and mourning for him. If it took blood to restore him to her, then blood she would supply, and not think twice of the consequences. In the days that followed, she found her smile again. Rory took the change of mood as a sign that she was happy in the new house. Her good humour ignited the same in him. He took to the redecoration with renewed gusto. Soon, he said, he would get to work on the second floor. They would locate the source of dampness in the large room and turn it into a bedroom fit for his princess. She kissed his cheek when he spoke of this, and said that she was in no hurry, that the room they had already was more than adequate. Talk of the bedroom made him stroke her neck and pull her close and whisper infantile obscenities in her ear. She did not refuse him, but went upstairs meekly and let him undress her as he liked to do, unbuttoning her with paint-stained fingers. She pretended the ceremony aroused her, though this was far from the truth. The only thing that sparked the least appetite in her as she lay on the creaking bed with his bulk between her legs was closing her eyes and picturing Frank as he had been. More than once his name rose to her lips. Each time she bit it back. Finally, she opened her eyes to remind herself of the boorish truth. Rory was decorating her face with kisses. Her cheeks crawled at his touch. She would not be able to endure this too often, she realized. It was too much of an effort to play the acquiescent wife. Her heart would burst. Thus, lying beneath him while September's breath brushed her face from the open window, she began to plot the getting of blood.